Marty Munn was a character. Coach and Marty had some good times together, especially when Marty had his mouthpiece in trying to explain what he was doing on the floor.
Mike Brown, a great leader. We knew he was going to be successful in whatever path he chose after USD.
One word to describe Chris Carr, Spider-Man. He had long arms, unbelievable defender. We needed to feed Chris a little bit more though, that's for sure. A little on the skinny side when he played at USD.
Paul Leonard was great. You couldn't even hear his feet hit the floor. He was so fluid. And then off the floor, slow as molasses, late all the time.
He was so silky smooth on the floor, you could not shake Paul Leonard at all.
In a word, Eric Musselman is feisty.
Fiery.
Eric Musselman, feisty, competitive. I think he got a few warning looks from referees, both from the bench and on the floor.
Scott Thompson, Triple T, better known as Too Tall Thompson. He could really, really score the basketball. For a 7-footer, he was an NBA talent.
Scott Thompson was a program changer. Great hands and feet for a big guy, and one of our all-time best.
David Fizdale was like having a coach on the floor.
I would say Jeff Probst is one of the most resilient, diligent people that I've been around. Went on to be very successful in his career.
Waymond Strickland was he's a crafty person, street smart, and court smart.
Coach Bennett was the one that recruited me to San Diego. I was incredibly lucky to be able to build a relationship with him. He's obviously a great basketball coach, but more than that, he's just a great human being.
Galen Dotton was a very good player, and because he was lefty, he was very deceptive.
Coach Hop, Hop Man as we like to call him.
Always looking to make a teammate better. He would pass up a good shot for a great shot for a teammate.
He's a great all-around guy, high character. Hank used to say he could be president one day.
After I was fired at the Air Force Academy, after 18 seasons, Bobby Knight put me on the staff as a scout for the 84 Olympic team in South America. And while I was over there, he was here in San Diego negotiating to use the basketball court here because he wanted to get away from all of the hubbub up in Los Angeles at the site of the Olympics. And they asked him if he had somebody to recommend as a basketball coach. And he said, yeah, Hank Egan. And soon got home and the phone rings. And I hear my wife say, don't worry about it, he's going. And the guy at the other end of the phone, Bobby Knight.
The transition from Jim Brevelli to Hank Egan, for me personally, was rather smooth. However, for some players, I think at the beginning there was a little uncertainty.
Well, there was an adjustment for all of us. Obviously, we went to USD to play for Coach Brevelli, and Coach Brevelli had a laid-back style. We would lay out by the pool our freshman year prior to every practice. Once Coach Egan came from Air Force, our poolside pre-practice routine completely ended, trust me on that.
But once they got to know Hank and saw his competitiveness, how hard a worker he was, and how he could strategize a game and get ready for a game, they were all on board. He wanted to win just as bad, if not more, than the players.
But by our senior year, it was unbelievable how Coach Egan had brought us all together. We were one happy family. And it showed on the floor, and maybe more importantly, it showed off the floor.
It was interesting, first of all, playing for Hank because he's from New York. And his accent, for about the first month, I didn't have any idea what he was saying. And I learned, once I figured out what he was saying, how good he was. He was tough and expected nothing but greatness out of us every day. And that's what he brought every day.
My first impression was that this is not going to be an easy job. And it was not going to be an easy job because is a team that had a lot of success. They went to the NCAA playoffs. And they were tough to play. So I felt there was a lot of pressure there to give this team the same kind of shot to do it again.
So the 86-87 season, in particular for me, was a little different because I transferred in. And so I wasn't eligible until we went on our road trip to Gonzaga in Portland. And so I used to joke around all the time because once I became eligible was when we went on our streak and we qualified for the NCAA tournament. We were sent to the Midwest Regional as the 9 seed in Indianapolis. And that was the year that Hoosiers came out. And we practiced at Butler Fieldhouse the night before the first round game, which is where Hoosiers was filmed for the championship game.
What is it? 15 feet.
15 feet.
And so as a team, we went and measured the court and measured the height of the rim. And a few of us actually went a little bit too far and shaved our heads.
1986-87 team was special. That's the only team, they had the same starting lineup all 30 games. They led the nation in field goal percentage defense, top 10 in scoring defense.
Guerreros were heartbroken after losing in the WCAC tournament. But yesterday, they were sky high after getting a bid to the NCAA tournament. A 24-5 record does all the talking, and now USC plays Auburn Thursday night in the Midwest Regional. The winner will probably take on Indiana. Right now, the Toreros could care less. They're happy to get this far. Here's what they think of the Auburn Tigers.
Yeah, I've seen them play in the past. They're usually one of my favorite teams on the track east, you know, and they've played type of game, power game. They have strength inside, pretty good backcourt, and they're just a big team, so it should be fun.
Well, actually, we're happy. You know, this is the last year for our seniors, and, you know, we thought we deserved to go. We won a lot of big ball games, and we had a good winning streak there, and, you know, we're glad that they recognize us, and we're happy to be there.
Right before we went out on the floor, we came back into the locker room in the NC2A tournament, and Coach brought us in, and usually we kind of talk a little bit last minute about what everybody's going to do in their role for the game, and he just said, we're past that. And what he said was, he said, you guys are going to be sitting somewhere when you're 40, 50 years old, sitting behind a desk wondering if you had done anything great. And he said, this is great. So enjoy it.
It was sort of like the Auburn game was, it was a foregone conclusion. Us going into the game that Auburn was going to kill us. Pound for pound, they were just, you know, they had all Americans. They had about 3 guys who were future NBA players. And, you know, being a coach and knowing the odds, I thought this was going to be a tough task. And there was a group of people who didn't think it was going to be that tough, and that was the team. And they just went out and played their butt off, and they didn't act nervous or anything. They just went after Auburn like, you know, this we're supposed to win. We get a breakaway with a little time on the clock, and Paul Lennon, one of the best players I've ever coached at any level. And he makes a steal and gets a breakaway layup. And going in for the layup with 2 seconds to go, he gets the ball hung on his hip. And we lose to Auburn in the first round of the NCAA playoff by 1 point. And we didn't lose the game because we gave in or quit or succumbed. We lost the game because they were just better, but they had a heck of a time proving they were better.
Let's start it. I'll never forget. I'm about to go on my last road trip at USD, and I stopped by Coach Egan's office just to say what's up. And I look on his coffee table, and on his coffee table is a USD magazine, University of San Diego magazine. And on the front cover of the magazine is a picture of Bernie Bickerstaff. So I read his story. Lo and behold, Bernie played at USD. He coached at USD. And Coach said, yeah, I know Larry Brown, because Coach was the head coach at Air Force Academy, and Larry Brown was the head coach of the Nuggets, and they'd have training camp down there. And then he said, I know Bernie Bickerstaff. He said, Bernie's an alum. He said, I know him well. I can put you in contact with him, see if we can get you an internship with the Denver Nuggets, because Bernie was the GM at the time of the Nuggets. I said, hey, that works.
I went in to talk to Bernie. I've known Bernie for years, and I said, Bernie, how about doing this? Bernie said, we don't have those in the NBA. And why don't you? And he said, I think maybe a good idea, you know, young guys, and you don't have to pay them a lot of money, and it's a training program for them. And he said, let me look into it. So he hired Mike Brown, and then it became contagious.
Bernie brings me out as an intern. That turns into a video coordinating job. I don't really know anybody, so I start bringing in Neil Meyer, Chris Grant, you know, get David Fizdale in as interns, and next thing you know, all these guys that came in as interns started moving up. They started bringing guys in, establishing relationships around the league, and now we have a pipeline of guys throughout the league in different or various positions.
Well, it's unbelievable because in the NBA circles, USD is known as the USD Basketball Mafia because we've had so many people that have had great careers and successful careers and big roles with NBA organizations. And it's absolutely incredible a school like USD would have such an imprint.
We recently had a kind of a Torero NBA basketball get together in Las Vegas, and we threw it together in about 3 days, and there was over 25 people there. And so all of us are unbelievably fortunate that this place, because of the people, Coach Bickerstaff, Coach Egan, the people, because they care so much about one another. And those young interns who are now assistant GMs in the NBA are calling him for advice now to this day. I think that's the point. Like, that's why we all love him.
Coach Egan really gave me a role, made me believe that it was my job to try to help guys get mentally ready to play. I had the authority or the liberty, so to speak, to really get after teammates if they weren't performing up to Coach Egan's standards. And he gave me that type of ownership to feel important, even with a lack of minutes on the court. And for that, I'll always be grateful, and it's carried over into all walks of life with me, whether it's my children and a role that they could have, or now as a coach, how we deal with guys that don't get a lot of minutes on our current team at Nevada.
All of our coaches, starting with Coach Egan, to Randy Bennett, to Kyle Smith, to Todd Lee, whoever was there, Jack Avina, they all had our best interests at heart. And so I felt, from that standpoint, we had a tremendous family environment because everyone cared about one another. Everyone wanted to hang out with one another, not just when it came to being on the court for a practice or for a game.
If I was to give Hank a message, I would say, Hank, I enjoyed your 10 years here. A lot of fun, shared a couple of cold beers on the road. The one thing that sticks out is your love of family. Every time we were on the road, how often you said, okay, I'll be right down. I got to give Judy a call and check in. So I always thought that was awesome.
Working with Hank as an assistant coach has been invaluable to me because I'm a high school coach today and have been for the last 22 years since I left USD. But really where Hank excels is his feel for people and his ability to mesh a group of young men into a team really is second to none, and to this day, those lessons maybe are what I take with me.
What I'm most proud about is that, and it wasn't something that I started, it's something I continue. And that's producing guys who are good basketball players, or good competitors, but they're also good students and good people. Not about numbers or statistics or anything like that, it's about people. And I think when I think about USD, I think it's about people here. It's, you know, they're players and they're students, but it's people business. USD gave me a second chance to do what I love, and I'll never ever forget it.